A presentation on production of iron and steel. The subject is engineering materials from which the topic has been selected. And the subtopics of this production of iron and steel are puddling furnace, cupola, and Bessemer converter. Myself, M. Kiran Kumar, M.Tech, CL Mechanical Engineering, Government Polytechnic, Kataram. So let us have a look about the topics covered till now in this particular chapter. As we know, the chapter name is Production of Iron and Steel. So as a part of introduction, we have studied extraction of metals, how the metals are extracted by different processes like pyrometallurgy, hydrometallurgy, etc. Next, we have focused on production of pig iron by blast furnace. And later, we have studied about the steel plants located in India. So now, let us start with the topics to be covered in this particular presentation. That is, first one, puddling furnace. Next is cupola. Third is Bessemer converter. So these three equipment we'll be studying, nothing but these three we'll be using for extraction of different variants of iron and steel. So let us start with the wrought iron to be produced in puddling furnace. Let us start with the flow chart. Let us have a flow chart of how the process is being carried out. So first, pig iron. Pig iron produced from the blast furnace is taken as raw material, and the removal of impurities at high temperature by oxidation in furnace produces wrought iron. So the furnace used here is puddling furnace. Puddling in the name indicates stirring, S-T-I-R-R-I-N-G, S-T-R-R-I-N-G, stirring. So this is the flowchart of pig iron transforming into the wrought iron. This is the output of blast furnace, and this is the output of puddling furnace. So the principle of puddling furnace. So here, the removal of impurities by oxidation from pig iron at high temperature in the furnace. So that is known as fettling. So because of oxidation, the pig iron, from the pig iron, impurities are removed. So impurities including silicon, manganese, phosphorus, carbon. So these are oxidized and removed. So finally, the wrought iron is obtained. So let us have a look about the puddling furnace. So here, this is the hearth portion. This is the hearth portion. And this is the charge. This is the fire door. So the molten metal, nothing but the pig iron, is taken and ignited. So after attaining the fire, then it separates, or nothing but the wrought iron is produced, and the flue or the flue gases will be evolved to the chimney. So here, this is the another diagram which shows the same puddling furnace. Here the stirring operation, nothing but the puddling operation, will be performed. So this is the hearth portion, and this is the heat produced in the fireplace, and that is the puddler's door, nothing but the charge door. So this is the puddle with semi-molten pig iron. These are the flue or flue gases evolved. This is a short wall. So let us start with the description. It is otherwise known as a reverberatory furnace. Puddling furnace can also be called as reverberatory furnace. The hearth of the furnace is lined with hematite. Hematite is nothing but the iron ore. It has low roof to deflect the hot gases and flames towards hearth. Hearth is charged with pig iron, the raw material. The furnace is fired so that pig iron melts. After melting, the molten iron or the molten pig iron is brought in contact with fresh air by continuous puddling or continuous stirring by long rods. Pig iron placed in hearth of the furnace and heated, iron oxide added in intervals for oxidation. So silicon, manganese are oxidized, removed as slag. Phosphorus is also oxidized and removed as slag, whereas carbon is oxidized and as carbon dioxide removed as gas. Wrought iron is obtained from the furnace. So first, pig iron is placed in the hearth of the furnace and heated. Iron oxide added in intervals for oxidation. Silicon and manganese are oxidized, removed as slag. Similarly, phosphorus also oxidizes and forms slag. Carbon oxidizes as CO2, removing or nothing but coming out as gas. So finally, we are getting the wrought iron in the furnace. So the reactions, chemical reactions taking place. So the first stage chemical reactions taking place. Silicon plus iron oxide, 2Fe3O4, gives silicon dioxide, SiO2, plus 6FeO. Manganese plus Fe3O4 gives MnO and 3FeO. Manganese oxide plus silicon dioxide gives MnOSiO2, which is nothing but the slag obtained at the bottom of the device. FeO plus SiO2, FeOSiO2, which is also the other form of slag formed. So now let us move to the second stage chemical reactions in this process. So 2P plus 5Fe3O4 gives P2O5 plus 15FeO. Phosphorus plus ore gives phosphorus plus iron oxide. P2O5 plus 3FeO gives Fe3PO4 twice, nothing but this is the slag. Third stage chemical reactions. 2C plus O2 gives 2CO, nothing but the carbon monoxide is evolved. 2CO plus O2 gives 2CO2, carbon dioxide. So these are the three stages of chemical reactions taking place in production of wrought iron from puddling furnace. So the composition of wrought iron, So the wrought iron has a 99% of iron. All others, including carbon, silicon, manganese, and phosphorus, has 1%. So coming to the properties of wrought iron, it is corrosion resistant. It has softness, toughness, low strength, easily weldable and forgeable. So coming to the applications where we can use this particular wrought iron. Use it for railway couplings, production of railway couplings. So production of crane hooks, boiler tubes, pipe fittings, plates, chains, etc. So this was the puddling furnace we have discussed. Now let us move to the next, production of cast iron by cupola furnace, or otherwise known as cupola. And let us start with the flow chart. 75% of pig iron plus 25% of steel scrap plus coke plus lime is taken as input. Air blasting and firing in cupola furnace is the next step. Molten iron tapped into ladle and casted into molds, finally becoming cast iron. So this is the flow chart of production of cast iron. First pig iron, 75% plus 25% steel scrap plus coke and lime is taken, and air blasted and fired in cupola furnace. Finally, the molten iron or the cast iron produced is tapped into ladles and casted into different molded shapes. Coming to the constructional details of cupola furnace. So, cylindrical shell, it is a cylindrical shaped furnace, nothing but a cylindrical shell lined with fire bricks. The shell diameter 0.9 meters to 2 meters height. And coming to the diameter, it is 4 to 5 times diameter. For example, if the diameter is 1 meter, we consider the diameter as 1 meter, then the height becomes 4 meters or 5 meters. On bottom, 100 to 150 mm thick sand bed is created with slope. Dry wood placed on sand bed. Coke charged on bed 0.75 meters above tires. It consists of metal 75% pig iron plus 25% steel scrap with a limestone and coke. All the above materials are arranged as alternative layers on burning on coke bed, which burns. 1 ton of coke, 10 tons of metal, 0.2 tons of limestone is taken. So here, this is the cylindrical form of cupola furnace. This is the dome-shaped spark arrester. This is the charge floor through here, and this is the charge door. This is the floor and this is the door. And handle to open and close the tires. This is the handle to open the tires. The bottom plate, this is the upper tire, nothing but the blast inlet. Lug for raising the door. Let us see the same parts again here. So this is the spark arrester. This portion is known as spark arrester. And let us see the different stages. From here to here, this is known as stack portion. So next is preheating zone, Why? Because the charge is fed through the preheating zone, and after feeding the charge, then the melting zone starts. Next, below the melting zone, we have superheating zone. Below that, tires and the slag portion. Finally, the molten metal stage is available here. And this is a tap hole for molten metal. Now, these are tires, T-U-Y-E-R-S, tires, nothing but the pipes. So this is the refractory lining of the cupola. This is the blast furnace for blast. This is a slag spout, nothing but the slag generated will be sending out. So this is fretling hole. This is a sloped and rammed, slope rammed sand bottom. Let us see the operating condition of cupola furnace. Coke is first lit at the bottom. Cupola charged from the charging door up to bottom of the door. Alternative layers of the charge, nothing but 75% pig iron plus 25% of steel scrap, coke and limestone are arranged alternatively at different layers. So air blast is input through the tires. And let us see the heating zones. First one is preheating zone. Preheating zone is available where the charge enters. Next, after firing, next nothing but the blast, next melting zone starts. Whenever the charge acquires more temperature, then it enters into the superheating zone. So let us see the preheating zone here, melting zone, and the reduction zone, or nothing but the superheating zone, finally the oxidation and reduction zones. So let us see the chemical reactions taking place in this particular cupola. The limestone melts and forms flux. The flux protects the metal from excessive oxidation. The lime fuses, forms slag with coke ash. Hot gases evolved during this process. Hot gases evolved during this process rise through the furnace and melts the iron. So 1% silicon and 1.5% manganese oxidized, and phosphorus remains unchanged. Nothing but the phosphorus will be as it is. Molten iron and slag is taken out in separate notches, whereas the molten iron can be tapped directly into the ladle or can be casted into different shaped molds. Composition of cast iron. The cast iron composition is iron of 92% to 96%, carbon of 2.5% to 3.75%, silicon of 1% to 2.5%, manganese 0.4% to 1%, and sulfur of 0.06% to 0.12%, phosphorus of 0.1% to 1%. So with this we have completed the cupola where we have produced cast iron. Now let us move to the third type of process known as Bessemer process, or otherwise known as Bessemer converter. So in 1856, Henry Bessemer of England discovered this particular process. So this mainly focuses on refining the molten pig iron in a converter. So that's why the Bessemer process, otherwise known as Bessemer converter. So in the Bessemer converter, it is a pear-shaped furnace about 6 meter high and 3 meter in diameter. So the capacity ranges from 10 to 25 tons of charge at a time. Nothing but the raw material can be input of 10 to 25 tons. So coming to the Bessemer process or Bessemer converter, a converter is lined with high refractory material. So it has three parts: detachable bottom, central cylindrical portion, upper conical portion, generally eccentric type. So first is a detachable bottom, second is central cylindrical portion, upper conical portion, generally eccentric type. So let us see the diagram here. So the charge is taken and the air, the tires, through these tires, the air is, because of the air, the more fumes are obtained, and this, because of this blast pipe, air blast is created and the pig iron starts purifying, and these are the fumes of that particular pig iron, and this is the lining. This outer portion is known as shell. This is a blast pipe for air blast. This is the air input. This is a trunnion. These are the tires, and this is air. So here we were discussing the Bessemer converter, and this is the diagram which illustrates. So here the pig iron is arranged along with these are the tires through which air in or air blast is created. So this is the slack portion, and this is a molten metal or molten tray. This is our Bessemer converter, a cylindrical portion. Nothing but a Bessemer process. So coming to the manufacturing of steel by the acid Bessemer process. So the difference between the acid Bessemer process and the basic Bessemer process, let us have a look. So the steel is made from pig iron by oxidizing the impurities that we have already studied. So coming to the acid Bessemer process. So the furnace is made of acid refractories, nothing but silica bricks or fine clay. So coming to the refractory materials used here in acid Bessemer process is silica bricks or fine clay. So let us see the process. Let us see the process by the basic Bessemer process. It is similar in the basic process, sulfur and phosphorus besides the other impurities are removed. So the converter is lined with dolomite or magnesite in a basic refractory converter. So the difference is dolomite or magnesite. So these are the refractory materials lined. So that is the difference between acid Bessemer process and a basic Bessemer process. So coming to the charge here, let us move to the charge. What is the charge taken? Molten pig iron along with cold steel scrap. So the molten pig iron can be directly taken from the blast furnace, and a cold steel scrap and a slag. So the principle, both acid and basic process are operated in Bessemer converter. The production of steel involves the removal of undesirable impurities which are obtained. The carbon content comes down to a specified value. The addition of alloying elements. Next, refining the molten pig iron in a converter. The body of converter is made up of steel plate and it is lined with silica bricks. The top of the converter is open. The bottom contains tires and a wind box. A hollow pivot which enables the converter to be rotated in three positions. So the main purpose of rotating the converter in three positions is, first is for taking the charge, second is while the process is going on, and third is for dumping the iron produced. So coming to the molten pig iron from blast furnace is charged into the Bessemer converter. First is the charging position. Let us have a look in the diagrams coming in the next slides. So first is charging position of the Bessemer converter. Second is oxidation of impurities of molten pig iron through cold air, which is blown under a high pressure in small streams through the bath of molten iron. So this is the slowing position. After decarburization, the flame drops and steel is tapped. That is the final pouring position. So let us see the diagrams here. Three positions of the converter. So first is charging position. This is the pig iron. Pig iron at from vertical position to the horizontal position, it has been turned. So after that, this is the slowing position where air blast is created and the fuel burns. Fuel and the metal is obtaining at a particular temperature. Then finally emptying or pouring the molten metal obtained. So that was the three stages of charging position, slowing position, and emptying position or pouring position. So coming to the Bessemer converter, this is the original Bessemer converter available in industries. As we have seen here, up to here it is a cylindrical shape. And here we are having a pivot point so that it can be rotated. It can be rotated so as to input the charge, slowing position, and pouring position. In order to obtain these three positions, a pivoting or a fixed here a position is obtained. So now this is the other diagram which shows the Bessemer converter. So here, this is again a sectional view of a pear shape inside. Here somewhat it appears like a cylinder, but finally it is a pear shape. So here the final steel obtained from the pig iron, the final steel obtained by the pig iron, which is produced by the oxidizing the impurities and carbon by blowing air through the molten pig iron. So in the converter, first charging position, second lowering molten pig iron just below the tires level. It is rotated upright position, blast of air forced through the tires at a pressure of 2 to 2.5 atmosphere, nothing but. So whenever it is positioned in upright, blast of air is forced at a pressure of 2 to 2.5. Then blast of air eliminates impurities and other carbon contents, etc. So oxygen or blast oxidizes iron into ferrous oxide. So here the equation is given. 2Fe plus O2 gives 2FeO. Iron oxide reacts with impurities like silicon, manganese, and carbon. Si plus 2FeO gives 2Fe and SiO2. So similarly, manganese plus FeO gives Fe plus MnO. Similarly, carbon plus FeO gives Fe iron plus carbon monoxide. Oxidation of impurities provides necessary heat required for the process. So silicon and manganese oxidized to form slag, whereas high phosphorus pig iron is charged into the converter. Silicon, manganese, and carbon are oxidized first. Then phosphorus is oxidized. 2P plus 5FeO plus 4CaO gives CaO 4 times plus P2O5 plus 5Fe, nothing but the iron. So FeS plus Mn manganese gives iron, Fe plus MnS. Similarly, FeS plus CaO gives FeO plus ECAS. So slag, whatever the slag obtained is poured off into the slag ladle after adding deoxidizers and recarburizers. So the difference between the acid Bessemer process and basic Bessemer process, let us have a look. First, in acid Bessemer process, the converter is, the Bessemer converter is lined with acid with a refractory material such as silica or fine clay. Whereas in the basic Bessemer process, it is lined with dolomite or magnesite. In the acid Bessemer process, slag is an acid, whereas in the basic Bessemer, it is a base or nothing but a normal slag. Acid Bessemer process eliminates silica and manganese only, whereas basic Bessemer process removes sulfur and phosphorus. Heat required is supplied by oxidation of silicon. Whatever the heat required for the process is supplied by oxidation of silicon. Whereas in basic Bessemer process, it requires long blows. Coming to the acid Bessemer, suitable for rails, axles, springs, vines, screws, bolts, nuts and fuses, etc. Suitable for nuts, grinders, bridges, structural sections, etc. So here, let us have a small summary of the total topics covered in this particular presentation. Initially, we have started with the production of wrought iron in puddling furnace. We have started with flow chart showing the actual process. in puddling furnace, impurities are removed at high temperature by oxidation process, forming wrought iron. So that is the principle of puddling furnace. We have studied with several illustrations and diagrams. So the other name given for the puddling furnace is reverberatory furnace. And we have already discussed that finally the product which we get from the puddling furnace is wrought iron. And some reactions, chemical reactions, we have studied in the form of three stages, first stage, second stage, and the third stage chemical reactions. So finally, we have studied that the wrought iron has 99% of iron and 1% of carbon, silicon, manganese, and phosphorus. Next, we have studied about the properties of wrought iron, which says that it is corrosion resistant, it has softness, it has toughness, low strength, but even easily weldable and forgeable. Coming to the applications, we have studied that it is suitable for railway couplings, crane hooks, boiler tubes, pipe fittings, plates and chains, etc. Later, we have entered into the production of cast iron in cupola furnace, started with flowchart. So we have studied that in a cupola furnace, air blast and firing happens. So changing the 75% of pig iron, 25% of steel scrap with coke and lime, finally forming cast iron. So several illustrations and diagrams we have studied, and different heating zones, reactions taking place in this particular cupola. Finally, we understood that composition of cast iron includes 92 to 96% of iron, carbon 2.5 to 3.75, silicon 1 to 2.5, manganese 0.4 to 1, sulfur 0.06 to 0.12%, along with phosphorus 0.1 to 1%. This is the composition of cast iron. So later we have entered into the Bessemer process, otherwise known as Bessemer converter. So we have studied about who have discovered this, Henry Bessemer, and continued with the operating condition and parts, labeling, and each and every topic concerned with the Bessemer converter with several illustrations. And other thing is, we have studied about acid Bessemer process and basic Bessemer process. The difference is, in acid Bessemer, we have furnace lined with acid refractories such as silica bricks or fine clay. Whereas in basic process, it is lined with dolomite or magnesite. So we have studied the working principle, the charge composition, and the working condition and the working principle. Finally, the different positions of the converter and final diagram, which is illustrating the real available Bessemer converter, a PS shape, and finally several chemical reactions to be taken place or chemical reactions in basic Bessemer process we have studied. And finally, we have discussed about the differences between acid Bessemer and basic Bessemer process. So with this, we are concluding this particular presentation. Thank you.